Let us discuss physical and chemical changes. So, suppose you have taken an ice cube and you are supplying some heat in it. So what will happen? After some time it will melt. Okay? So when this ice cube, what is the formula of ice? It is H2O. The formula of ice is H2O. So when it melts, it becomes water. The formula of water is also same, that is also H2O. So that means here some changes has taken place. What kind of change is that? That it has converted from solid to liquid. But the chemical formula has not changed. So this type of change will be known as physical change, where the chemical formula remains same. Only some physical changes takes place. Physical change means here what type of change? That is the change of state. It was solid, now it is liquid. Similarly, if you boil it, if you heat more, then what will happen after some time? That water will be converted to vapor. Then also, when it is a vapor, the formula will remain same. That will still be H2O, but there will be some physical change. What kind of physical change is that? It has converted its state from liquid to vapor. But the formula is still same. So that is physical change. Okay? Now, chemical change. Chemical change means, suppose when two objects or two substances are undergoing some chemical reaction, then the substance, the new substance which is formed, that new substance does not show any property of its constituent substances. Suppose, for example, sodium chloride. Sodium chloride means the salt that we take. So in that salt, it is a combination of sodium and chlorine. So sodium has its own property, chlorine has its own property, but when they combine, that is a chemical change, because the newly formed sodium chloride does not show the property of sodium and it does not show the property of chlorine. That means the property of sodium and chlorine is totally not observed in sodium chloride. So that is what type of change is that? It is a chemical change. Okay? And the new substance which is formed, that is a completely new substance. It has no similar properties with its constituent particles. So this kind of change is chemical change. Suppose, for example, when water is formed, water means it is a combination of oxygen and hydrogen. So when oxygen and hydrogen were separated, then oxygen was a gas, hydrogen is also a gas, but when they combined, they formed water. And in water, we don't get any property of oxygen and hydrogen. Water completely, it has its own property. So that is why, what kind of change is that? It is a chemical change. Alright, now let us distinguish these physical and chemical changes from these questions given here. Classify the following as chemical and physical changes. Number one, cutting of trees. So cutting of trees is certainly, it is a physical change. There is no chemical reaction taking place. Next one, melting of butter in a pan. So melting is a physical change. Okay. Then rusting of almira. Rusting means some chemical reaction is taking place. So rusting of almira will be a chemical change. Okay. Boiling of water to form steam. So boiling of water to form steam, that is also a physical change. Passing of electric current through water and the water breaking down into hydrogen and oxygen. So here water is decomposed, water is it is broken down into hydrogen and oxygen. So that means it is a chemical change. Okay. Then dissolving common salt in water. If you dissolve common salt in water, the property of salt is not going to change. In fact, if you evaporate, then what will happen? The water will go away, the salt will still remain there. So that is a physical change. Okay. The next one, making a fruit salad with raw fruit, that is a physical change. Burning of paper and wood, that is a chemical change, because in most of the cases burning forms smoke. So if burning forms smoke, that is a chemical change. Then try segregating the things around you as pure substances or mixtures. So that one you can find out, you can see what are the things present around it and you can classify them into into pure substances and mixtures. But before that, obviously we will discuss about pure substance and mixtures. Okay, now in the next topic, this one. What are the types of pure substances? Okay, generally, broadly, we classify. Okay, I'll show you this chart, then it will be much more clear for you. This one. Okay, see here, this matter means what are the different types of matter, solid, liquid and gas. Then see, it is classified into two types. One is pure substance, the other one is mixture. Remember that pure substance and mixtures are two different categories of what, of matter. Then again you see that pure substance is again classified into two types, elements, compounds, and mixtures are also classified into two types, homogeneous and heterogeneous. So already the mixture part we have discussed, homogeneous, heterogeneous mixtures, we know that. Now we are discussing about pure substance, the two classification, two types of pure substance, elements and compounds. Alright, then this one, elements. Okay, suppose pure substance, generally it means there will be one type of particle. Suppose if I say water, only water, so water is a pure substance because we have only water molecules there, no other particles. Okay, but if I say salt solution, so what are the things present there? One is salt, one is solution, means what, water. Okay, so two things are present there, so that is a mixture, salt and water. Now one very important thing about mixture is that in mixtures, when the substances are there, those substances show their own property even in mixture. Suppose if I say sand and iron fillings, suppose some pieces of iron, it is mixed with sand. In that case, that is a mixture, no doubt, because we have two types of things, one is iron, one is sand. But those particles, means iron and sand, both will retain their own property even in mixture. That means, suppose if you bring a magnet near them, that magnet will attract the irons, right? Because iron still, though it is in a mixture, it is not giving up its own property, it is showing its property. So remember that in a mixture, the constituent particles will always show their own property. Their own property will not be destroyed. Okay? But in compound, suppose I told you about NaCl, means sodium chloride. So sodium chloride is not a mixture, but it is a compound. The reason is that in sodium chloride, what we have is sodium and chlorine. So sodium and chlorine, when we take, sodium is not showing its own property in sodium chloride. Chlorine is also not showing its own property in sodium chloride. As a result, sodium chloride is not a mixture, but it is a compound. Okay, followed. Next, this one, what are the types of pure substances, elements and compound? We will discuss about the mixture and compound afterwards also. We have one topic here, this one, mixture and compounds. Okay, but before we go there, let us discuss this one, elements. So as I told you, that pure substances here, that pure substances are classified into two types, elements and compounds. Now what are elements? So generally in elements, we have one type of atom. Suppose, for example, one type of atom means, suppose if I say oxygen, oxygen is an element because here only oxygen atoms are there, or oxygen molecule is there. Okay, if I say hydrogen, that is an element. If I say iron, the formula is what, this Fe, so that is an element. If I say sodium, only one type of particle is there, which is sodium, so it is a element. Okay, these are elements. Basically, when you write the chemical formula, in that case the element, the concept of element gets more clear. Suppose oxygen, we write O2, so only O is there. N2, nitrogen, only nitrogen, that is, it is an element. But what are compounds then? If I say H2O, it is water, no, H2O. So in H2O, it is a combination of two elements. One is H, means hydrogen, the other one is O, means oxygen. So it is not an element, but it is a compound. So what is a compound? A compound is a substance composed of two or more elements chemically combined with one another in a fixed proportion. Very important part, in a fixed proportion. Fixed proportion means H2O. Okay, H2, that means in water, to form one molecule of water, we need two hydrogen, H2O, and one oxygen. We never write H3O, H4O, no. Water means it is always H2O. That means to form one molecule of water, we need two atoms of hydrogen, one atom of oxygen. That's what is written here, that combine with one another in a fixed proportion. Fixed proportion, the proportion is always fixed. Okay, that is a compound. Now, this element, it is again classified into three types. You can see here, elements can be normally divided into metals, non-metals and metalloids. So certain properties are there of metals. First one, they have a luster, means it is shiny. They have silvery gray or golden yellow color. Okay, they conduct heat and electricity. All right, they are ductile, that means it can be drawn into wires. Ductile means stretchable, you can stretch them to a certain length, and in that process they do not break down. So that is ductile. Next one, they are malleable. Malleable means it can be hammered into thin sheets. Suppose for example aluminium foil we have. So aluminium foil means, aluminium means it is a metal, so when it is beaten it forms a foil, so that means it can be hammered into thin sheets. Then they are sonorous. Sonorous means it is a pleasant sound. It forms pleasant sound when you hit it. Okay. Then some examples of metals are given: gold, silver, copper, iron, sodium, potassium, etc. One very important part, mercury is the only metal that is the liquid in room temperature. So generally metals are solid, but mercury is such metal which is liquid at room temperature. Now metals, non-metals, some properties of non-metals are listed here. Number one, they display a variety of colors. Okay, non-metals, their colors are not fixed. Next one, they are poor conductors of heat and electricity. Yes, they are poor conductor, because you can see that the wires, when the wires are made, we use metal, we don't use non-metal to make wires, right? Because they cannot conduct electricity or heat. Next one, they are not lustrous, sonorous or malleable, so they do not show all these properties. Okay, the third type of element is metalloids. So what is metalloid? Okay, some examples of non-metals are given: hydrogen, oxygen, iodine, carbon. Carbon means it may be in the form of coal or coke. Then bromine, chlorine, etc. Some elements have intermediate properties between those metals and non-metals. They are called metalloids. Intermediate properties means they show some properties, some metal-like property, some non-metal-like property. So they are intermediate, in between. Okay, those are called metalloids. Some examples are given: boron, silicon, germanium, etc. Okay, so this is all about elements and compounds. I told you that it is a combination of two or more elements where they get combined with one another chemically and in a fixed proportion, right? Then we will discuss activity 2.10, but before we do so, first we will discuss this part. Okay, this table, mixtures and compound. After this difference, we will, the last topic is this one only, that activity 2.10, then we will discuss about it. Okay, mixtures and compounds. The first point is given in mixture. Elements or compounds just mix together to form a mixture and no new compound is formed. Okay, suppose nothing new is formed. Suppose just now I told you that if you add some iron pieces with sand, it is not forming anything new. Iron will remain as iron, sand will remain as sand. In fact, by any process, you can separate them also, by the process of magnetization. Means if you hold a magnet near them, iron will be attracted by the magnet. Sand will not be attracted, so you can easily separate them. So that is a mixture, where elements or compound, they just mix. That means they do not form anything new. But in compounds, elements react. React means they undergo chemical reaction to form new compound. For example, I told you about sodium chloride, which is the common salt that we use. So when sodium gets added, or when sodium reacts chemically with chlorine, then it forms sodium chloride. And once you form sodium chloride, you cannot separate sodium and chlorine from them physically. Without any process, you cannot do that. Some chemical process may be there, that is a chemical thing, okay. Physically you cannot do anything. So that means compound means it is a completely new substance, new thing is produced there. Okay. Then number two, a mixture has a variable composition. Of course a mixture may have a variable composition. Suppose if you are asked to make a mixture of sand and like iron only, sand and iron, then what they will do? You do not, if you are instructed that make a mixture of iron and sand, someone may take 50 gram of iron, some may take 100 gram of iron, some may take 200 gram of iron, then also it will form a mixture only, alright? But if someone says that make water out of oxygen and hydrogen, you cannot add any amount of oxygen, any amount of hydrogen. No, you have to add something fixed. So see the number two point in compound, the composition of each new substance is always fixed. Means H2O. So two hydrogen and one oxygen atom only you have to add to form a complete molecule of water. You cannot do anything. Okay. So that is compound. Next one, point number three in mixture. A mixture shows the properties of the constituent substances. Okay? Yes, of course, a mixture shows the properties of constituent substances. I'm giving you the same example again, iron and sand. Iron is showing its property, sand is showing its property in mixture. They are not they have not given up their properties. Okay? But number three point in compounds, the new substance has totally different properties. Okay? So totally different properties. It does not show the property that they had initially before undergoing the reaction. Then next one, last one. In mixture, the constituents can be separated fairly easily by physical methods, correct? But in compound, the constituents can be separated only by chemical or electrochemical reaction. Just now I told you that if you mix like sand and iron. Iron and sand you can easily separate by physical method. Physical method means till now we have discussed different processes, no? How to separate the components of mixtures, distillation, then separating funnel. So all these are physical processes. So by any physical process you can separate the mixtures. Okay, suppose magnetization is also a physical process. Means if you hold a magnet near these iron filings and sand mixture, it will attract the iron filings and sand can be separated by physical process. Okay, this is applicable for mixture. But for compound, the constituent can be separated only by chemical or electrochemical reaction. Suppose if somebody says that you have water, means H2O, now separate hydrogen and oxygen from there. You cannot just stretch and break them out, right? So what you have to do is, you have to apply something chemical reaction, some chemical process, some chemical reaction has to take place there to make them separate. By physically means by distillation, by separating funnel, or by evaporation, or by sublimation, you cannot do so. So any physical process is not applicable to for compound, for the separating the different components of a compound. Okay, so this is all about mixture and compound, very important thing. Then this table already I told you, and exercise questions also we will discuss. So in next video what we will do is, we will discuss this one, activity 2.10, and all these question answers. So for today, thank you.